So welcome back. We are looking at the whole subject of heaven, of hell, of eternal judgment, of these massive things. And we left part three off with asking the question, well, doesn't God get what God wants if God loves everybody, if the potential in Jesus' death was paying for every single sin on the planet, and that God wants nobody to perish, then surely everyone getting saved, everyone finding faith, is what God wants. Does God get what he wants? It sounds like a good argument, doesn't it? That surely everyone's going to get saved because God's all-powerful, and if he's made the way for everybody, and if he's desperate for that to happen, you know, it seems wrong, doesn't it, almost, to say God doesn't get what he wants. The problem with God getting what he wants argument ends with God just saving everybody, irrespective of their response to the gospel in this life. It makes the whole thing God and nothing to do with us. It makes faith, which is a defining call of the entirety of Scripture, completely redundant. You know, faith all the way through from Abraham, the first guy to go, yes, believing by faith in God all the way through. Completely, well, what's the point of that? There's nothing we need to do. We just get saved. Then there has to be some option for people after death. Because if, well, God gets what he wants and everybody will get saved, really, because God's a God of love, then after they've died, there's God just waits and waits and waits. There's some sort of maybe holding position for those not in Christ after death, where surely, inevitably, like some spiritual evolutionary process, everyone will eventually claim the free offer of salvation by grace. It sounds nice, and of course we want everyone to find faith, but it quickly gets very confusing, completely speculative, utterly contradictory of Scripture, and based on my created image of God. In Luke 13, verse 34, Jesus says this, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how often I have longed to gather your children together, as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing." We see there Jesus, the Son of God, longing to gather the people of Israel, of Jerusalem, sorry, gather them together. What a beautiful picture, like a hen gathering her chicks. But Jesus doesn't get what he wants. Why? Because they were not willing. They said no. The wonder that God is desperate for something, willing to die to get that something, and despite having the power and glory to force the issue, allows us to choose. That's called love. That is what love really is. Others will argue against the idea of punishment. Eternity. Eternal life sounds like a good concept, doesn't it? Yeah. Non-stop joy, rest, peace and fullness sounds like something Jesus would give. But eternal death? Non-stop distress, pain, anguish and sorrow? I don't like that. I found that thought that it could be true for people really, really hard. Agreed? The word used here in the Greek means for eternity means age-like, age-long. It describes a period of time. There is no word in Greek that quite matches our word eternity, meaning to us unending. Some will argue that therefore hell is not never-ending, that Jesus is not talking about forever as we might think about forever. It's a period of time, a season. Problem is, the same word is used of eternal life. Does God only give a temporary, limited time period for fullness in him? I don't think so. Judgment, this moment when you go one way or the other, when there's a separation between the righteous in Christ and the unrighteous, biblically always carries a finality about it. Nowhere in any sense is it limited. A further problem is when the same word is used to describe the Holy Spirit in Hebrews 9 verse 14. Here he's called the Eternal Spirit. He's not just around for a season, for a time, is he? Don't the spirit existed before and existed after this world. He is God. You can't change the word for one thing and not for the other. Again, we need to take the whole thing and not pick and mix verses and words we like, or things we can deal with or fit our image of God. God's anger is his permanent opposition against the contaminating, destructive perversity of sin, which is self, which is me, which is stuff being about mine. It's me on the throne of my life. Ezekiel 33:11 says, "As surely as I live, declares the sovereign Lord, I take no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but rather that they turn from their ways and live. Turn from your evil ways." What a stunning verse found in the Old Testament, guys. God is not rubbing his hands together, licking his lips, looking forward to throwing people into an eternal hell of torment. This is so important. Hell was not prepared for people. Matthew 25:41. "Then he will say to those on his left, 'Depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels.'" We read about that in Revelation as well. Hell was for Satan, for the demons. Never created for us. So if hell is a never-ending separation from God, awaiting many, what is that like? What does that really mean? It's not an easy thing to talk about, is it? And it's a really sobering subject. So I want to share three vivid, difficult pictures of how hell is described in the Bible. Firstly, fire. Hebrews 10:26-27. "If we deliberately keep on sinning after we have received the knowledge of the truth, no sacrifice for sins is left, but only a fearful expectation of judgment and of raging fire that will consume the enemies of God." Matthew 13:49-50. "But this is how it be at the end of the age. The angels will come and separate the wicked from the righteous and throw them into the blazing furnace. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." Revelation 20:13-15. "The sea gave up the dead that were in it, and death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what they had done. Then death and Hades were thrown to the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death. Anyone whose name was not written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire." Jude 1:7. "In a similar way, Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding towns gave themselves up to sexual immorality and perversion. They serve an example of those who suffer the punishment of eternal fire." Mark 9:43. "If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It's better for you to enter life maimed than with two hands and go into hell, where the fire never goes out." Difficult pictures. Here, fire representing pain. The second picture is weeping. Matthew 8:11-12. Jesus speaking to the Israelites who thought they were in just by their national birth. "I say to you that many will come from the east and west and take their places at the feast with Abraham, Isaac and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the subjects of the kingdom will be thrown outside into the darkness, where there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth." Matthew 25:41. "He'll cut him to pieces and assign him a place with the hypocrites, where there'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth." Luke 13:27-28. "But he will reply, 'I don't know you or where you come from. Away from me, all you evildoers.'" There'll be weeping there and gnashing of teeth when you see Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and all the prophets in the kingdom of God, but you yourselves thrown out. The word here in the Greek speaks of bitter grief that springs from feeling utterly hopeless. This is weeping brought on by uncontainable emotional pain. And thirdly, anger. There is a punishment for sin. There is a cost you pay for choosing your own way. You reap what you sow. God has paid the ultimate price to rescue you from this fate, making a way to step into holiness, into relationship with him. But rejecting that offer is to scorn his sacrifice, to treat with contempt his love, and there's no way out of that wrath. Hell is a place of his anger, his permanent opposition to sin, the perversion of his creation. Wrath is a result of a holy God meeting unholy man. Romans 2:8 says, "But for those who are self-seeking and who reject the truth and follow evil, there'll be wrath and anger." Hebrews 10:31, "It is a dreadful thing to fall into the hands of the living God." They're really difficult pictures, aren't they? If anything should stir us to reach out, it's these things, because God is perfectly just. No one will be able to say, well, that's not fair. We can't see everything. We don't see, but we've got to believe, because he's a kind God, that everybody has had at some point the opportunity to say yes, to look that way, to let God reach in and to reach out for him. He can't do wrong. Revelation 21:1-4 says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there's no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There'll be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away.'" We've read these verses before, haven't we? Fantastic. Oh, could do read them every day, couldn't we? Beautiful verses. "This is the fullness of the salvation offered freely by Jesus for his death for us upon the cross." What a picture. But if the offer of life is to be fully united with God, the opposite, the penalty for rejecting Christ, must be full separation from God. Hebrews 1:2-3. In these days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom also he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. Colossians 1:15-17. "The Son is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and by him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together." God did not make the world like some huge Swiss watch, wound it up and well, off it goes. No, he's, despite fall, despite sin and evil, he's still there. He's the glue that holds the very fabric of it all together. I believe the descriptions of hell strike at the very essence of what it is to be shut out from the presence of God permanently. Without God present, all is unquenchable fire. All is anguished weeping. All is hopeless darkness. Quite a few years ago, we were on holiday in France, and we just arrived after a very long drive in the Annecy region over in the Alps. Children were a lot younger then, and we went for a bike ride. And it was just from our house where we were staying, and we went up this hill, and we started to come down the hill the other side, and I'd sort of ploughed on ahead, getting rid of a bit of the rust from the journey, getting the cogs whirring, and I got to the bottom of the hill where there was a T-junction, and I think I had summer on my bike there. I suddenly heard a scream from Catherine and turned round to see her coming down the hill, but then Ethan ahead on his bike. I can't remember, maybe he was about 6 or 7 then. And he'd obviously panicked. Maybe he was too tired. And he was just careening down this hill, holding on for as hard as he could. He told me later he realised he couldn't remember which brake to pull, you know, because he didn't want to pull the front brake and go over the handlebars, so he just had frozen, and he's careening down this hill out of control, heading towards a T-junction. So either he was going to hit traffic, or the other side of the T-junction was just a big drop, maybe 15, 20 foot. Without a moment's thought, I took someone from a bike, turned round, ran towards the danger, ran towards Ethan careening down the hill, and just grabbed hold of the front of his bike by the handlebars. Even at his little age, the force of it caused me to go completely head over heels. And amazingly, Ethan was completely uninjured. I smashed my knee, stone got lodged in it, I had to go to the hospital to get some stitches. But actually, we were okay. I was wounded, and amazingly, Ethan was fine and completely safe from danger. If I, a fallen, mixed up, imperfect father, without a moment's thought, would just happily run with no care of my own state to rescue my child, to be wounded for my child that they might be saved, how much more is the cross, the death and the resurrection for all mankind? And how much more is it my job and yours, whilst we're still alive, having tasted from the grace and the goodness of God, to rescue people from an eternal separation from God into an eternal relationship with a loving, kind, magnificent, spectacular, awesome, incredible eternity with Jesus. Love can win.